In this video, we are going to see the concepts of input and output statements, operators, conditional statements, loops, jumping statements, and arrays. First is input-output operation. For input-output operations, we use the header file hashtag include stdio.h. First is output operation. For output, we use the function printf. The syntax is as follows. We use the keyword printf. And within parentheses, we mention the format string and the list of variables separated by commas. This format string specifies us the number of variables, the type of each variable. It also tells us the width, that is the number of columns that should be used for printing the value, and the precision, that is the number of decimal places correct to which the value must be printed. As stated, but it's compulsory to mention the number and type of variables. Here you can see the general format for the format string. Here W, P, and C are only placeholders and can take in different values. In place of W, we mention the width required. In place of P, we mention the precision. And C here is the conversion character. So in place of C, we mention different characters based on the type of variable that we want to print. For example, we use small d for integer, small f for float, small c for character, and so on. So here you can see a piece of code. Before going into this code, many a times we don't want to just print the value of a variable, but we want to print the value embedded in a statement. For example, here we want to print the value of f1 is, and then the actual value. So in that case, we can write the statement directly in the format string, and in place of percentage %f or percentage %d, the value gets substituted. So here you can see the output. So first, for the first printf, it prints the value of f1 is 23.4290. Then the second printf, it prints the value of f1 is 23.429. This is because here we have mentioned the precision as 3. So it prints it correct to 3 decimal places. Sometimes we don't want to print the value of any variables, but we just want to print a sentence. So in that case, we can skip the variable part and just write the format string part with the sentence in it. For example, in the third printf, we have just mentioned the end within quotes, and that gets printed. Next is the input statement. Similar to printf for output, we use scanf for input. The syntax is similar to printf, except that we, instead of mentioning the variable, we mention the address of variable. The format string, this we have an integer variable z, and we are scanning in the value of z using scanf and printing the same using printf. So next is operator. The first set of operators is the arithmetic operator. Arithmetic operator include addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and the new one modulus. This is denoted by the percentage symbol. Whenever we say x modulus y, it gives us the remainder when x is divided by y. Precedence of arithmetic operator. So this precedence is similar to the Bodmer's rule. The first priority is given to the parenthesis, that is the brackets. And second priority is given to multiplication, division, and modulus. All these three have the same priority, and whichever comes the leftmost gets executed first. Third priority is given to addition and subtraction. Even in this case, whichever comes the leftmost gets executed first. So for example, in this we can see we have b into c divided by d modulus e. So here in this case, first b into c is executed, then that is divided by e, and finally the modulus is taken with e. So next, the relational and logical operator. Relational operator includes lesser than or equal to, greater than or equal to, double equal to, and not equal to. Logical operator includes and, not, and or. Both these operators have a common thing, that is they give only Boolean values, that is they give only true or false as their answer. Like relational operator is self-explanatory. In logical operator, this not means a negation. And in and or, we give in two output and we get one output. In or, and if at least one of the given output is false, it gives us false. In or, if at least one of the given output is true, then it gives us true. So logical operator is usually used to connect to relational operator. As you can see in this case, we have two relational operations, A less than B and C less than D, and it is connected by and logical AND operator. So from this, it is clear that the precedence of a logical operator is lesser than that of a relational operator. So in this case, you can see A lesser than B evaluates to 1 if A is lesser than B, or else it becomes 0. And A double equal to 10 or A lesser than B. So it becomes true if at least one of the condition is satisfied, otherwise it becomes false. Next is increment and decrement operator. Increment operator is denoted by plus plus and decrement operator is denoted by minus minus. Prefix is change before action. We mention the operator and after that we mention the variable. Postfix is change after action. We first mention the variable and then the operator. So here you can see a piece of code. It has three variables x, y, and n. N is initialized to 10. So when we do x equal to n plus plus, it is a postfix. So first x gets assigned to value 10, then n plus plus is done. So the value of n becomes 11. Y equal to plus plus n, it's a prefix. So value of n becomes 11 plus 1, 12, and value of y becomes 12. So the output here is 10, 12, and 12. Next is conditional statement. So first conditional statement is a simple if statement. Whenever we want to execute a particular piece of code, if a condition is satisfied, then we use this if statement. So syntax is first we mention the keyword if, and within parenthesis we mention the condition, and below that we write a block of statement. So as you can see in the flowchart here, first the condition is checked. If the condition is true, then the body of if gets executed. If it's false, then the body of if is skipped. So here we have a program to find the minimum of three integer. So here the idea is to first input the three integers and to store and to consider that the first integer is minimum and compare it, that integer with other two, and update the value of min. So here we can see, so we have scanned in the value of x, y, and z. We have written minimum equal to x, and we have two if conditions. If y is lesser than min, we are making min as y, and in the next if we are checking if z is lesser than min, then we are making min equal to z. Finally, we are printing the value of min. Next conditional statement is an if else statement. So whenever you want to execute a particular part of program, if a condition is satisfied, and some other part, if the condition is not satisfied, then we use this if else. The syntax is similar to simple if, except that we add an else part and a block of statements to it. So as shown in the flowchart, first the condition is checked. If the condition is true, then the code corresponding to the body of if gets executed. If it's false, then the code corresponding to the body of else gets executed. So here we are interested in printing marks corresponding to the grades. First we scan in grades. If the grade is A, we print 90 to 100. If it's B, we print 80 to 90. For any other input, we print it as invalid character. So here you can see, here we are first inputting the character. We have an if statement. If it checks if the input is either A or B, so within that if we have an if else part. So in that if we are checking if the input is A, we are printing marks is between 90 to 100. Else it means that input should be B, so we are printing 80 to 90. So in the outer else part, it binds with the outer if thing, and this comes when the input is neither A nor B. So in this case, we are printing that it is an invalid character. Next is an if else if ladder. So whenever we want to execute different pieces of code for different cases, we use this if else if ladder. So here you can see the syntax. So syntax is similar to if else, but we add several else if with corresponding conditions and block of statements in between it. We can add any number of else if conditions in it. So here, as shown in the flowchart, first the condition one is checked. If it's false, then condition two is checked. Even if it's false, then condition three, and it moves so on. So if all the condition fails, then the else part gets executed. So in this process, if any one of the condition becomes correct, then the code corresponding to it gets executed and everything after that is skipped. So here we are going to print the marks corresponding to the grade. We have already seen this using simple if else. So we are going to see it using if else if ladder. So here we are inputting the character. We are checking if the input is A, then we are printing that marks is between 90 to 100. So in else if part, we are checking for B, and in the else part, we are printing it as an invalid character. Next is a switch construct. A switch construct can be used as an alternative for if else if ladder. So the syntax is as follows. We mention the keyword switch and we mention an expression within parentheses, and within a block we mention different cases with the values of the expression. And finally, it's important to mention a default thing. This default is analogous to the else part in the if else if ladder. So here we can see the flowchart. First, the case one is checked. If it's satisfied, then statement one gets executed. If it's not, then it moves on to case two, case three. And if all these cases fail, then the default statement gets executed. So it's important to note that we have a break in between two cases. So if we skip the first break, then if case one is satisfied, then even statement one and statement two gets executed. This is called as fall through. So we will see more on about break in the later sites. So here we are interested in printing the marks corresponding to the grade. In this, we are going to use the concept of switch. So here we are inputting the character, and we have a switch construct with cases as A, B, and default. In A, we print that marks is between 90 to 100. In B, we print 80 to 90. And in default, we print it as invalid character. So it's important to note that we have break between after case A and case B. So after default, break is not necessary. So one-time mini calculator. So here we are scanning in three things: integer x and integer y, and then character op. So here, based on the input given for op, we perform different operations on the variables x and y. So we have a switch construct here. We have different cases within it. So case plus, minus, multiplication. For plus, we return x plus y. For minus, we return x minus y, and all those things. Here, important thing to note is that for division, we have written x into 1.0 by y. This is because both x and y are integers. So when we mention x by y, even the result would be round off to an integer. So even if we have mentioned the conversion character as f, it would return an integer. So to avoid that, we should convert any one of x and y into a float thing. So for that, we are multiplying x with 1.0. Next is loop. Whenever we want to repeat the execution of a set of statement, we use a loop. The loop executes as long as the condition is satisfied. So here you can see a flowchart in which first the condition is checked. If the condition is true, then the code gets executed one. Again, the condition is checked. This repeats itself until the condition becomes false, then the loop gets terminated. So first loop construct is in while loop. In the syntax, we use the keyword while and then expression within parentheses, and we mention the set of statements within it. So in this flowchart, you can see executed. So this repeats until the condition becomes false, when the loop gets terminated. And the important thing to note here is the value of expression must change in the statements, or else this will become an infinite loop. So this is true not only for a while loop, but for any loop. So here we are interested in constructing a mini calculator. We have already seen a one-time calculator, but we want to repeat it for n number of times until the user wants to quit it. So here we are going to use the concept of loops to achieve the same. So here similarly, we are scanning in the value of the operator first. We have a while loop. And we are checking if the operator is not equal to Q. So here before this, we have informed the user that if he wants to quit at any point of time, he should give the operator as Q without giving normal operators like plus, modulus, or something. So within that loop, we are scanning in the value of integer, and the switch part is same as what we have written in the previous example. And after that switch part, within that while loop itself, we are scanning in the value of operator. We are doing it inside the while loop so that it doesn't become an infinite loop. If we do it after the while loop, then value of operator doesn't get updated, so it becomes an infinite loop. Next is finding GCD of two numbers. Here we use the Euclid concept. According to Euclid, GCD of x comma y is equal to GCD of x minus y comma y. And with our knowledge on the modulus operator, we can say that it's equivalent to GCD of x modulus y comma y. So here we have a code. So this code works only when x is greater than y. So if we get the input such that x is lesser than y, we are swapping those two. For swapping, we use a variable temp, and first we are storing value of x in temp, then value of y in x, and finally value of temp is again stored in y. So in this we have a while loop with condition x modulus y is not equal to 0. Within that while loop, we compute x modulus y and store it in x, and finally we are swapping the value of x and y. So this loop runs as long as x modulus y is not equal to 0. When it becomes 0, this loop gets terminated. So when we say x modulus y is 0, then it means that y is a factor. So GCD of x comma y should be y. So finally, we are printing the answer as y. So next is for construct. So in for, we use the keyword for, and within parenthesis, we mention three things. The statement one, this is the initialization statement, expression, that is the condition, and statement two is the update statement. So as you can see in the flowchart, first the initialization statement gets executed, then the expression gets checked, and if the expression is satisfied, then the statements gets executed once. Then the statement two, that is the update statement, gets executed. After that, the expression is again checked. So this repeats as long as the expression remains true. For finding minimum of n integers, so before we have seen a problem for finding minimum of three integers in which we used two if condition. So here we want to find the minimum of n integers. So in this case, instead of using n minus one if conditions, we would use the concept of loops. So here we are scanning in the value of n, and first variable we are directly scanning in variable called min. So here we have for loop running from 0 till n minus 1. Here it's running from till n minus 1 because already we have scanned in one variable, and we have to scan only n minus 1 variables hereafter. So we are scanning the variables variable one by one and storing it in a current int, and if current int is lesser than min, then we are updating the value of min as current int. Then after the loop, we are printing the value of min. Next is testing if a number is prime. Here we are going to use the concept that a prime number has only two factors, that is one and itself. So first we are scanning in the value of n, and we have a variable called flag, and it's assigned 0. So here we have a loop in which I is running from 2 till n minus 1. So inside that we are checking if n modulus I becomes 0. So if n modulus I becomes 0, then it means that I is a factor of n. So n is not a prime number. So in that case, we are making flag as 1. So outside the loop, we are checking if the value of flag is 1. Then we are printing not prime. In the other case, we are printing it is prime. So next is a do while construct. So it is an exit control loop, unlike other two loops, in which first the condition was checked, then the execution was started. Here the loop execution starts first, then the condition gets checked. So here we can see the syntax. We use the keyword do and a block of statements below it. After that, we use the keyword while and a condition within parentheses. Here, important thing to note is that we have a semicolon after that condition. So in this flowchart, you can see that first the code gets executed, then the condition is checked. If the condition is true, then the code gets executed again. So even if the condition is false, the code would get executed at least once. So here we are going to find the GCD of two numbers using the concept of do while. Even here we are going to use the Euclid's method. So here the program is similar to the previous one, except that here we are changing the condition within while, and also we have changed the instead of printing y, we are printing x as the final output. So this is because in the first case, if we get two numbers such that y can divide x, for example, if we get it as 4 and 2, so with since the loop runs once, the value of x becomes 2 and the value of y becomes 0. So when we check while of y not equal to 0, so then the loop gets terminated and finally we are printing the value of x here, which is 2. Next is jumping statement. So first jumping statement is break. So break is used to terminate a loop when it is encountered. So syntax is simple. We just mentioned the keyword break and a semicolon after that. Here you can see the flowchart. So if a break statement is executed, all the remaining iterations are skipped and the control moves outside the loop. So here you can see a piece of code. We have a for loop running from 1 till 9, and we are inside that we are printing the value of i. So if value of i becomes 5, we are breaking. So in this case, the output, we get only the first four numbers. When I becomes 5, it comes out of the loop. So other numbers doesn't get printed. So next is continue. So continue is used when we want to skip remaining part of current iteration and move on to the next iteration. Even syntax is similar to break. We just use the keyword continue and a semicolon after that. Here, as you can see, so whenever a continue gets executed, all the statements below that in that current iteration get skipped and it moves on to the next iteration. So here you can see a similar for loop used in the previous example. So when I becomes 5, we are giving continue. So then we are printing the value of I. So here all the values get printed except 5, because when I becomes 5, continue gets executed. So this the printf statement below the continue gets skipped, and in the next iteration I becomes 6. Next is nested loop. Whenever we have a loop within a loop, then it's called as a nested loop. So you can see the flowchart here. First, the condition of the outer loop is checked. If it's true, then it moves on to the inner loop. The inner loop runs in the same way like any normal loop. And it's important thing to note here is within a single iteration of the outer loop, all the iterations of the inner loop is completed. So here we are going to print all prime numbers within a range. We are going to use the concept of nested loops here. So here we scan in two values, low and high, showing us the range. Here we have outer for loop running from low till high, and inside we have written the same program that we have used for checking if a number is prime or not. So here the input for the inner loop comes from the outer loop. So for each value of n, the corresponding inner loop runs, and for each value of n, we check like if that n is prime or not. So outside that inner loop, we are if the number is prime, then we are printing it, or else we are doing nothing. So the next loop, the loop runs for the next value of n. So printing patterns. So nested loops are used extensively for printing patterns. So in this case, we are interested in printing this following pattern. Usually the outer for loop is used for rows, and the inner for loop is used for columns. Here, as you can see, this is similar to a lower triangular matrix. So here, since the number of rows is 5, we have outer loop running from 0 till 5, and we have inner loop which is running from 0 till it is lesser than or equal to I. So when value of I is 0, the inner loop gets executed once and star is printed. When I becomes 1, inner loop gets executed twice and 2 stars are printed. So here it is important to note that we have a printf of slash n after the inner loop. Here slash n is an escape sequence that moves the cursor to the next line. So here it is important, otherwise all these stars would get printed on the same line. So here we are interested in doing this pattern. This pattern is a little bit more complicated than the previous one. So for this, we use two for loops within the outer for loop, one for printing those spaces and the other for printing those stars. So here we have 7 rows. So the outer for loop runs from 0 till 6, and the inner for loop for spaces runs from 0 till 6 minus I. The second for loop is similar to the previous one, which we used for printing star. So when I is 0, the value of the k runs from 0 till 6. So 6 spaces are 0 till 5, so 6 spaces are printed. And in the second loop, when value of I is 0, the loop runs once and the star is printed. So even in this case, we have written printf of slash n, otherwise all stars would get printed on the same line. Next is arrays. So when we want to store several elements of the same data type, we use arrays. So the syntax is as follows. We use first mention the data type, then the array name, then the size of array within square brackets. So the important things is that the number of elements in an array is finite and it's fixed. The elements are stored in contiguous memory location. So as you can see in this picture, we have an array named marks of size 5. It has 5 elements: 90, 86, 89, 76, and 91. So all these elements are stored in contiguous memory location. So when here we also have a variable named sum with value 432. You can see that this sum is not contiguous with the array elements. So here important thing to note is that the sum can be contiguous with the array elements, but it is not necessary. But when we declare an array, all the elements must be necessarily contiguous. Initializing an array, there are different ways of initializing an array. In the first way, we mention the name of the array on the left hand side. On the right hand side, we mention all the array elements separated by commas, enclosed by curly brackets. Here we haven't mentioned the size, but the size by default becomes 3. And after this statement, count of 0 gets the value 10, count of 1 gets the value 23, and so on. So in the second case, on the left hand side, we have mentioned the size. But on the right hand side, we have mentioned only one element, but the size is 10. So in this case, the zeroth index gets the value 0 and all other elements have garbage value. So you can also initialize an array using loop by getting the input from the user or directly by giving the values. So common mistake is failing to initialize the elements. Many just declare an array but fail to initialize it. This may result in some error in programming. So here we are going to evaluate a polynomial. So this polynomial is given by a0 plus a1x plus a2x square till an x power n. a0, a1 till an are coefficient. X is the value of the variable and n is the degree. So here we have an array int coefficient of 21. Here we are assuming that the maximum degree is 20. So you can even mention it as n plus 1 after scanning in the value of n. Here after that, we are scanning the value of n and x. We have a loop running from 0 till n. And within that loop, we are scanning in the value of coefficient. And the value of polynomial is calculated using the expression value equal to value plus coefficient of I into POW of x, y. So here POW is an inbuilt function. So we know that POW of a, comma b gives us the value of a power b. And finally, after the loop, we are printing the value. So searching in an array, first search is a linear search or sequential search. So it iterates through the array elements till the match is found or we have reached the end of the array. So here you can see we are going to search an element 20. So first the zeroth index element is compared. This is 10, so it doesn't matches. So next the first index element 50 is compared. Even it doesn't matches. So it moves on till the sixth index where it matches. Then the program gets terminated. So here we are going to see the code for linear search. So here we have a for loop running from 0 till n minus 1. So inside that we are checking if the value in that particular index matches with the key. So if it matches, we are printing that the key is found at position I. Is used only for sorted array. First in this we first check the middle element. If the middle element matches, then we break it, or else the middle element would separate the array into two parts. We decide which one of the part would be suitable and repeat the process again in that part. So here you can see, here we are searching for an element 15. First the middle element has index 4, it has value 12. And since 12 is lesser than 15, and this array is in ascending order, so we have only chosen the right hand part to check. Again, in the right hand part, middle is at index 7. So here middle value of middle is 18. So 15 is lesser than 18. So again, we choose the left hand side. So now the array into consideration is only has two elements, 15 and 16, with index 5 and 6. So here the middle becomes index becomes 5 and the value matches with 15. So here we are breaking the program. So here is the code for binary search. Initially the value of start is 0 and end is n minus 1. Within loop we assign mid as start plus n by 2. So if the value at mid matches with key, then we are printing that the value is found at mid and we are breaking. So if a of mid is lesser than key, that it means we have the element is found somewhere on the right hand side. So we make start as mid plus 1. So if in the other case, the element should be in the left hand side. So we are making it as min minus 1. So sorting an array, first is a selection sort. So in selection sort, first we find the minimum and place it in the first location. Then we repeat the process from the second position. So here you can see in the first part of step 1, first 20 and 12 is compared. Since 12 is lesser than 20, 12 gets here and 20 gets into first position. Then 12 and 10 is compared. So in that way, at the end of step 1, the minimum element gets placed on the 0th index. So similarly, step two is done, starting from the first index. So in this way, at the end of four steps, we get the array arranged in an ascending order. So here we are going to see the code for selection sort. Here we have an outer loop running from 0 till n minus 1, and we have an inner loop which runs from I plus 1 till n. So here we are checking if ARR of I is greater than ARR of j. In this case, the value with lower index is higher than the value with higher index. So in that case, we swap those two so that we get an ascending order. So first repeating element in an array, here we are going to use the concept of selection sort. So in this code, you can see that the for loop construct is similar to that of a selection sort. So inside the inner for loop, we are checking if ARR of I matches with ARR of j. So in that case, we are printing the value of ARR of I, and we are making flag as 1 and we are breaking. So we are checking if in after that inner loop, we are checking if flag is 1, then again we are breaking. So here you can see the use of break, because we have to just find the first repeating element and print that only. Even if more elements are repeating, we should skip that one. So here we are breaking the inner loop, and if the inner loop gets broken after printing the value, then we have to break out of the outer loop also. So for that purpose, we are using the flag variable. Sorting an array in ascending order, here this one uses insertion sort. So insertion sort, first the array is split into two parts. One part is sorted and the other part is unsorted. And in each iteration, an element is taken from the unsorted array and it's placed in the correct position in the sorted array. So this is similar to playing cards. Like in this, you can see in the zeroth iteration, so only 5 is in the sorted array. So in the first iteration, so first element, second element 3 is taken, and its ideal position would be before 5, so it's placed there. After that, when 8 is taken, it's in the correct position. So after that, when 4 is taken, so 4 should come after 3 and before 5. And finally, when 6 is taken, it should come after 5 and before 8. So at the end of 5 iteration, we get the correct sorted array. So here we are going to see the code for insertion sort. So here we are running an outer loop from 1 till I, and we are storing ARR of I in key. So in a for loop, we check j goes from I minus 1 till 0, and this runs only if ARR of I is lesser than ARR of j. So if that condition is satisfied, then all the elements from j to I is pushed one position forward using ARR of j plus 1 equal to j. So here this is important because we have seen before that insertion sort is similar to playing cards, and in cards directly we can insert one card between two cards, but in case of arrays, in order to insert one element, we have to push all the elements after it by one position, then place that element in the gap which is created. So after this inner for loop, we are doing ARR of j plus 1 equal to k. In the using the statements, the gap is filled with the key. So here one might ask why ARR of I is stored in key. We can directly use ARR of I in place of key everywhere, but in the inner for loop, since the elements are pushed, the value of ARR of I gets changed. To avoid that, we are storing the value of ARR of I in key and we are using key everywhere. Next is strings. So strings is nothing but an array of type characters. The syntax is similar to a normal array. So except that we have a data type as character instead of any other data type. So similar to a normal array, there are different ways of initializing a character array. So in the first case, we mention the name and the size on the left hand side. On the right hand side, we mention a string. So here all the elements from index 4 gets assigned with garbage value. In the second case, we mention all the characters separated by commas, enclosed by curly bracket, similar to a normal array. So in the third case, we are scanning the value of the string from the user. So for any normal array, we would have used for loops to scan all the elements one by one. But in case of strings, we can directly use the conversion character as yes, and we can directly scan in the value. So here we are going to write in program to check if a given string is a palindrome or not. For a palindrome string, a reverse of the string is same as the given string. So strlen is an inbuilt function that gives us the length of any string that we give it. For example, strlen of arr gives us the number of elements in that string arr. So within that loop, we are checking if an element from the starting is same as the corresponding element from the end. So if that matches, then when we reverse that string, then the reverse of the string would match with the original string. So here, if in any case, if the character from the starting doesn't match with the character from the end, we are making flag as one and we are breaking. So if the flag has the value one, then it means that the characters doesn't match, so it is not a palindrome. In the other case, we are mentioning that it is a palindrome.